Welcome to Platts latest gas and power watch video. I'm Stuart Elliott, Platts senior gas writer, and I'm here today with Siobhan Hall, our senior Brussels correspondent. Today we're going to be looking at Russia's planned Nord Stream 2 gas pipeline to Germany. It's a politically controversial project and it's due on stream by the end of 2019, the same time that Gazprom's 10-year transit deal with Ukraine also comes to an end. This is not a coincidence, as Russia wants to reduce its transit gas flows through Ukraine to Europe, with potentially huge consequences for both Ukraine and the countries that Russia supplies in Southeast Europe. Siobhan, when do you think Nord Stream 2 will actually come online?
Well, I think this end of 2019 start date, it's pretty tight, and it's by no means certain that it's going to come on stream. And you can see from this timeline here that the Nord Stream 2 developers want to get all their permits completed by the end of 2017, and they want to start laying pipe in 2018 in order to meet the end of 2019 start date target. But you can see if there are any delays or any problems at any point along that timeline, then that start date could slip.
And obviously Ukraine is in its interests to be able to continue transiting Russian gas to Europe. So for them, they perhaps will still want to have their transit agreement in place with Russia.
Yes. I mean, the big question is, will Russia have to talk to Ukraine or can Russia ignore Ukraine? And the thing about the Nord Stream 2 project is, even if it's not built, because we don't know yet absolutely that it will be built, just the prospect of Russia being able to build this pipeline means that they can go into any negotiations with Ukraine with a much stronger hand for a new transit contract. But there's some brinkmanship going on, because if Russia doesn't get it built in time, then when they go into they'll be forced to go into those negotiations, and then Ukraine will have a stronger hand, but only until the pipeline comes on stream.
Right, and Russia has actually said, I think, that they will continue to flow gas through Ukraine after the end of 2019, so even if Nord Stream 2 is or isn't built, because there are certain countries, aren't there, in Southeast Europe that can only be supplied via that route through Ukraine. So one thing seems clear, that regardless of Nord Stream 2 being built or Ukraine and Russia agreeing a transit agreement, gas will still flow through Ukraine post 2019.
Yes, so we've got a chart here that shows how Russia used the Nord Stream 1 pipeline to reduce flows through Ukraine. You can see that on this chart. And if they were to build Nord Stream 2, we could see that those flows could go down to maybe a very small percentage. I mean, at the moment, Russia is putting maybe half of its exports to Europe through Ukraine. Before Nord Stream 1 was built, it was putting around 80% of its exports to Europe through Ukraine. So Ukraine has been a very important transit route. The idea that only a very small amount of Russian gas flows will go through Ukraine would really change how the gas flows around Eastern Europe work.
Mm-hmm. We can see here as well that overall flows of Russian gas to Western Europe are rising. You know, they're on the up. Is there still going to be demand, do you think, for Russian gas in the EU in the coming years?
Well, we've got another chart here that looks at the demand outlook. And you can see here that these are from the International Energy Agency. You can see that their forecast in 2005, when the Russians decided to build Nord Stream 1, is a lot higher than the forecast they did in 2015, which is last year, when Russia decided to build Nord Stream 2. So we can see that the demand outlook for Nord Stream 2 is a lot worse than it was for Nord Stream 1. I mean, there's another thing going on, which is at EU level, there is the push to cut emissions and the push to use more renewables. And the US is setting itself goals for 2030. And the European Commission's forecasts for gas demand in 2030 are actually even below what the IEA is saying here. So the demand outlook is not as good as it was for Nord Stream 1.
Sure, although there's one other important point we mustn't forget, isn't there, which is that European domestic gas production is falling quickly. So Europe is going to need imports to fulfil its needs. Imports from Norway are falling, from Algeria aren't for sure in the future. So Russia still has a strong hand to play. It's still a very important player in the European gas market.
And that's one of the things I wanted to ask you. I mean, can Russia still make money from selling gas to Europe? Because I understand that gas prices, global gas prices, have been coming down in recent years.
Yeah, if we look here, we can see it's been a pretty disastrous time for gas producers worldwide. Prices have fallen across the board. So it's a lot much harder to make money from gas. But Russia is in a very strong position, actually, because among the global gas producers, its production costs are among the lowest. So rather like Saudi Arabia in the oil market, Russia can produce gas very cheaply,
right,
and sell it then, of course, at a lower price, but maintain its market share, which Gazprom has said is a priority in Europe. It wants to make sure it keeps its share of the market or even increase it. And they're in a pretty good position to do that.
Okay, so it sounds like even though the market conditions and the demand forecasts are not as good for Nord Stream 2 as they were for Nord Stream 1, Russia still has some commercial grounds to build the pipeline. And then there is a separate issue that it does give it a stronger hand in its negotiations for any future transit through Ukraine.
Right, and I think that's going to be the next big thing to look for, isn't it? What is going to be the conclusion, if you like, of the Russia-Ukraine standoff over transit? And
yes,
what do we need to look for?
Well, then the next big thing that's going to happen there is that both Russia and Ukraine have been disputing the current transit contract at the arbitration court in Stockholm, and we're expecting a ruling on that possibly before the end of the year. And Gazprom has said that it won't come to any talks on a new transit contract until there is that ruling. And when we get that ruling, we'll then have an idea of just how serious Gazprom is about continuing to use Ukraine as a transit route, because if it is serious, it will come to the table. And the other interesting thing there is that Ukraine wants the European Commission to be involved in those talks, because it wants to emphasize that this is a European issue, not just for Ukraine. So that those talks, whether they happen or not, that's going to be a big European issue for some years to come.
Okay, well, that's something for us to keep a close eye on then.
Yeah.
Thanks for watching, and join us again for the next Gas and Power Watch.